start. So now we have four centers connected, or they'll be joining very soon. So in the introductory session, we'll discuss the fundamentals on industrial automation and robotics. So madam, you can switch to presentation. So as all of us know, okay, in this presentation, this is the layout. We'll have introduction to automation, then a brief introduction to actuators, something brief about PLC and robotics. So in the first session, I will not be going through the whole of the presentation, but I'll go through as is required in the introductory session. So as all of us know, automation is doing something without or with minimal human assistance. So automation can be defined as the technology by which a process or procedure is accomplished without human assistance. The term automation was coined by a person, Del Harder, who was working in Ford Motor Company in the year 1946. For implementing automation, we need a program of instructions combined with a control system that executes the instructions. So when we talk of control system, the control system will consist of primarily four components: actuators that will actually do the work, sensors which will provide the feedback about the various parameters, the controller which will receive information from sensors and accordingly switch on or switch off the actuators or change their speed, etc. And the fourth major component is the signal conditioning. Now, if we talk of levels of automation, then we can divide the automation into five levels.
Automation robotics?
No, that is upstairs. So levels of automation, we have at the topmost level, enterprise level, then plant level, then cell or system level, machine level and device level. When we talk of enterprise level, there we have major functions which are required for planning, marketing, accounting, design, research, master production scheduling. That is the functions which are concerned with the top management, or you can say about the sales and procurement. At plant level, then we talk of planning the manufacturing. So here we have order processing, process planning, inventory control, purchase, material requirement planning, shop floor control, and quality control, etc. Then we come to actual manufacturing, where we have cellular or system level. Here we have part dispatching and machine loading, coordination amongst the machines, material handling systems, and collecting and evaluating inspection data. So as a cell or a group of machines will consist of a number of machines, so next is the machine level. So within a machine level, we have automation pertaining to sequencing, timing, and overall control. So for example, in a machine, we'll have sequencing. We will load a workpiece, clamp a workpiece, then a tool will start. Similarly, timing, a machining operation may be performed for a given time. And the overall control of the individual machines. And finally, we have the device level, where we have control of individual actuators. At this level, we talk of actuators, sensors, and other hardware elements like signal conditioning and controllers. So in this course, we are mostly focused on the device level, and where we will learn that how different components, they are combined to form the fundamental of automation. Now, talking of fundamental of automation, as all of us are aware, today all the machines are a combination of mechanical, electrical, electronics, software, etc. So the foundation of automation is, we can say, mechatronics, which is integration of mechanical, electrical, and microprocessor based control systems. Any process that we carry out is basically mechanical, because all manufacturing will require some kind of machining or forming or joining, which has to be performed by actuators. Now, actuators may be electromechanical, or they may be electrohydraulic or electropneumatic, and their control is primarily microprocessor based along with the software. So mechatronics term was coined by a Japanese engineer, Mr. Tetsuro Mori, from Yaskawa Electric Company in 1969 to reflect the merging of mechanical and electrical engineering disciplines. So Yaskawa Electric Company is still a very famous company for electric motors and robots. The term mechatronics gained legitimacy in academic circles in 1996 with the publication of the first referred journal, IEEE and ASME Transactions on Mechatronics. So this journal is a joint publication of three IEEE societies and one ASME society, IEEE Industrial Electronics Society, Robotics and Automation Society, Laser and Electro-Optics Society, and ASME's Dynamic Systems and Control Division. Now, going a bit more through the history, if we talk of the decade of 1970s, so there mechatronics was concerned mostly with servo technology used in products such as automatic door openers, vending machines, and autofocus cameras. So these applications were simple in implementation. The approach encompassed the early use of advanced control methods. In the next decade of 1980s, as microprocessors became smaller yet powerful, engineers began to embed microprocessors in mechanical systems to improve their performance. Numerically controlled machines and robots became more compact, while automotive applications such as electronic engine controls and anti-lock braking systems, they became widespread. Then in 1990s, the internet or the communication technology was added to the mix, yielding products that could be connected in large networks. This development made functions such as remote operation of robotic manipulator arms possible. Microelectromechanical systems, commonly known as MEMS, such as tiny silicon accelerometers that trigger automotive airbags, arrived on the scene. Now, in the past two decades, that is in the decade of 2000 and in the present decade which is going on, something more has actually now come in, which is not present in my presentation, but otherwise I will discuss it. So in 2000, technologies such as data mining, cloud computing, they arrived on the scene. And internet also, it became pervasive. And I think in the decade of 2000, we could not believe that life is possible without internet. As a result of this, in the present decade, that is 2010, another technology known as IoT, that is Internet of Things, is now fast becoming a reality. And by 2020 or 2025, it is estimated that more than 50 billion devices will be on the Internet of Things network. In fact, the manufacturing industry is already awake to this situation. And in 2010, in Germany, a standard called as Industry 4 standard has been proposed. So Industry 4 has been named so because now they are calling it the fourth revolution in industry. The first industrial revolution is attributed to steam power. When steam power was, they started to use steam power for industrial machines. Then second industrial revolution is concerned with the electrical energy. The third with electronics, because the miniaturization of electronics, it resulted in automation going to a very, you can say, large level. So the fourth is now called as Industry 4 Revolution, because here now we have the automation, the data mining, the cloud computing and Internet of Things, which is going to revolutionize the manufacturing industry. Now, coming back to our present course on automation, first of all, let us see an example of servo feedback. Right. Now, when we talk of manufacturing, as I said, we may have a machining, a forming, or maybe a joining process. Even nowadays, we have a rapid prototyping technology, which is called as additive technology. Even if we consider that, the fundamental is that a workpiece will move relative to a tool. So in this application, let us consider a work table on which a workpiece is to be mounted. And this work table is to be moved through a distance X, which is a function of time. Now, the first problem is, or the first challenge is, how to move the work table. Naturally, if we want to move a table or a chair on the floor, we can use muscle power. But when we are talking of a machine, the work table will be moved by an actuator, so very commonly by an electrical actuator. So here we see electric motor, which is coupled to the work table. Now the coupling is through lead screw mechanism. Electric motor is now an electromechanical device. The lead screw is a purely mechanical device, along with the work table. The electromechanical motor will provide us a mechanical motion in the form of a rotary motion when electrical energy is given to it. The lead screw is designed to convert the rotary motion into linear or translational motion, and accordingly the work table will move. Now here our problem is to move the work table through X. So if we keep on rotating the motor, ultimately the work table will be stopped by mechanical stops on the two extremes. But not considering the mechanical stop, say we want to move it through 5 millimeter or 5 inches, anything, that is small X. So to move it through a certain distance, it is very fundamental that we measure that how much that table has moved. So for measuring, we will need some kind of a sensor which will measure the displacement of the work table. So the sensor will keep on measuring the instantaneous displacement of the work table and provide information to the system. Now, as an automation, it is the controller which will control the whole process. So it is fundamental that the sensor that we use is a kind of sensor which will convert the mechanical parameter into a electrical signal. So this electrical signal will be then given to a controller, and to the controller, the operator or the user had already given a position command, that is how much X we want the work table to move. For example, in the case of a microwave oven in our homes, to the controller we provide normally the time for which we want the operation to take place. And when we start the microwave, the instantaneous time is measured, and when the instantaneous time becomes equal to the time that the user has specified, the microwave will stop. So the same thing is here. The user has provided to the controller the reference position, that how much displacement the work table should go through, and the sensor now provides the instantaneous position of the work table. So, but if we look at our this slide, from the sensor to the controller, the connection has been shown by a dashed line. Why? Because we need some other thing in between the sensor and the controller, that is signal conditioning. Because we should remember that the output of a sensor may not be suitable for a controller. Suitable in many forms. For example, the output of the sensor may be a very small voltage which may not be discernible for the controller. The controllers are all electronic devices, electronic circuits consisting of microprocessors and other ICs. So they may be working on 5 volt, 10 volt, 12 volt, etc. Whereas the output of a sensor may be in millivolt or even microvolt. So first thing is that the output of the sensor has to be amplified. Second is, the controllers are all digital devices which work on digital signals, whereas a sensor in this example, it since it is measuring displacement, which is an analog variable, so the output of the sensor will be analog. So this analog signal has to be converted into a digital format. So at least these two conversions are required, some kind of amplification and conversion from analog to digital. Some other conversions or other functions are also required. For example, filtering, because the output of the sensor may contain some noise also, so that has to be filtered out so that only the desired signal is given to the controller. So all these things, amplification, analog to digital conversion, filtering, and maybe a few more, they are covered under the heading of signal conditioning. Now on the output side, the controller is connected to the motor again through signal conditioning circuit, so which may again consist of digital to analog conversion, some kind of amplification or attenuation, because there will be driver circuits for the motor. So in this manner, what we get is a closed loop system. So in the closed loop system, now we have a process which is the work table, which is to be moved through a certain distance. For doing that, we have the actuator, that is the motor, which is electromechanical device, and we have sensors, signal conditioning, and controllers, which sensors may be electromechanical or electro, you can say electronics. Signal conditioning and controllers will be only electronics along with some software part. So what we see is that whenever we are talking of an automation system, the components from all the branches of engineering will play their role. So typically we have seen that at least the three fundamental components are controllers, actuators, and sensors. Now controllers can be a variety of types: microcontrollers, digital signal processors, programmable logic controllers, single board computers, personal computers. Similarly, actuators, they may be based on electrical energy or they may be fluid power actuators, and variety of sensors for measuring different types of parameters like position, proximity, displacement, velocity, acceleration, force, pressure, liquid flow level, temperature, light, humidity, any gas, composition, anything. So that means an automation system consists of all type of components, mechanical, electrical, electronics, and software. So talking of purely mechanical components, we may have pneumatic and hydraulic actuators, kinematic chains, cams, gear trains, belt and chain drives, bearings, etc. Electrical, we may have solenoids for small movements, for example, in fluid power control valves, then AC motors, DC motors, stepper motors, and we'll have a different type of electronic component like operational amplifiers, analog to digital converters, that is ADC, digital to analog converter, that is DAC, filters, data acquisition systems, controllers, etc. Now, actuators are primarily electric or hydraulic or pneumatic. So what you see on the computer screen is a brief comparison between three types of actuators on different parameters like energy source, energy storage, distribution system, energy cost, actuator, force and hazards. Electrical actuators, they take their energy from outside. That is from in our industry or in our homes, we receive the electrical energy from outside, from a power station through a grid. Hydraulic and pneumatic actuators are electric motor or diesel engine driven. Energy storage is limited in electrical actuators. We can store energy in batteries. In hydraulics also it is limited. In accumulator we can store oil at high pressure, but it is good in pneumatic systems. We can store energy in large reservoirs, that is a compressed air can be stored in large reservoirs. Distribution system is excellent with electrical systems because there the losses are minimal. In hydraulics it is limited, in pneumatics the distribution system is good in between the electrical and hydraulic systems. Energy cost is lowest in electrical system and highest in pneumatics. Actuators, AC motors are very cheap. In fact, they are called the workhorse of the industry. In DC motors, we can have good speed controls and we can also have short linear motions with solenoids. In hydraulics, we have low speed but with very good speed control and we can have large linear movements. Similarly, in pneumatics also, we can have large linear movements directly. We have a wide speed range, but the speed control is difficult and even position control is difficult because of the compressibility of the air. Force wise, electrical systems give a low power to weight ratio. Hydraulic systems give the highest power to weight ratio and pneumatic systems give medium power to weight ratio. Hazards wise, electrical systems, there is a danger of electric shock. In hydraulic system, if there is oil leakage, it is dangerous. People can slip, oil can catch fire, and it also doesn't look good. In pneumatic systems, we don't have any hazards except for noise when the air leaks. So this is a very brief introduction to fluid power systems. Hydraulic system, they use incompressible medium like oil. Their operating pressures are high, 150 bar. So as our atmospheric pressure is nearly 1 bar, so you can see the operating pressures are quite high, but they produce noisy and wear inducing shocks in the piping as it works at high pressure. Pneumatic systems, they use compressible medium, mostly air, operating pressures are 10 bar, 15 bar, 20 bar, and they are softer in action because of the, again, air compressibility. In fluid power systems, the basic elements are power sources, cylinders, control valves, and fluid lines. In power sources, hydraulic systems will use hydraulic power packs, and pneumatic systems, they require air compressors. Cylinders can be single acting, double acting, rotary also. Control valves, we require three types of control in fluid systems. One is directional control. That is because cylinder has to be moved in two directions, in the forward direction and in the backward direction. Then flow control. The flow of oil or air has to be controlled so that the speed of the piston in the cylinder can be varied. And pressure control is required because so that we can have different pressures and hence different force available at the piston for doing the work. Then to connect the different components, we need fluid lines. There may be piping, there may be tubing. So it's a very simple line diagram of a single acting cylinder where we have a barrel. Inside the barrel, there is a piston. For a single acting cylinder, there may be spring on one side of the piston. So if we push the air or oil into this side, the piston will move forward, and when the fluid is taken out, then the spring will push the piston back. For a double acting cylinder, we have two ports, say X and Y. So when the piston is to be moved in the forward direction, we will push the fluid in through X and take the fluid out through Y from the other side of the piston. The piston will move forward. And to move the piston backward, we will push the fluid in through Y and take the fluid out through X. So this is not required now. Now, as it's an introductory lecture, so I would like to show you some animations about fundamentals of how hydraulic or pneumatic systems work. Because from there only we will develop a understanding of that how does the controller play their part in automation. Now if you look at this diagram, what you see is a single acting cylinder. It's a pneumatic cylinder with a piston and a spring on one side. The other side of the piston is connected to a directional control valve, which in this case is a 3x2 valve. Now it is called 3x2 because it has three ports. The first port is the pressure port, which is connected to the air compressor. The second port is the working port, which is connected to the cylinder. And the third port is the exhaust port, through which air can be released to the atmosphere. The valve has a body in which the ports are made, and inside the body there is a spool. This spool can be moved down by applying a mechanical force here or a manual force, and it can be moved up by this spring. So when no mechanical force is acting on it, the spring will keep the spool in this position. And in this position, as you can see, the pressure port is blocked. The pressure port is blocked and the working port is connected to the exhaust port. Therefore, the pressure is atmospheric in this area, in this tube, and on the left hand side of the piston. When we will move the spool down, the larger diameters of the spool will block the exhaust port, and the pressure port will get connected to the working port. The compressed air will flow into the cylinder and the cylinder piston will move forward. So let us see the animation. So when I run the animation, you will see immediately a dark blue color occupying this portion. So the dark blue color indicates compressed air. So as you saw in the animation, that when the spool is in this position, the compressed air is blocked here. But when the spool moved down, the compressed air flowed into the cylinder. So we can see it once more, then we will proceed further. Now, let us see a double acting cylinder. So, in this, we don't have a spring in the cylinder. So, that means air has to be pushed in on two sides of the cylinder depending upon which direction do you want to move the piston. So, for this, now we are showing here that we are using 2 3x2 valves. To move the piston forward, we will operate this valve so that compressed air from the cylinder through the T connector and through this valve will flow to this side of the piston. And the piston will move forward. And when we want to move the piston backward, then we will operate this, the other valve. So then the air from the compressor through the T connector will flow through this valve and go into the cylinder on the other side of the piston, and the piston will be pushed backward. So let us see its animation. So what we just saw, that when we start the simulation, when both the valves are closed, the compressed air is blocked here as well as here. So only when we operate a particular valve, accordingly the air flows into the cylinder and then the cylinder piston moves. Now up to this point, we have used valves which are purely mechanical. Now in the next step, we have a electromechanical system. Here the cylinder is same, that is double acting, but now the valve is different. Number one, instead of two valves, we have only one valve. Number two, the configuration of this one valve is different. So this is a 5x2 valve. Why? Because it has five ports. First is the pressure port. Then second and third are the two working ports. Then fourth and fifth are two exhaust ports. So we say 3x2 when the valve has three ports but two positions. So if we recollect our previous animations, the valves had only two positions. In one position, the pressure port was connected to the working port. In the second position, the working port was connected to the exhaust port. Here also we have two positions. In one position, which you can presently see, the pressure port is connected to working port A and the second working port B is connected to the exhaust port S. Whereas in the second position, when this spool will be moved towards left against the spring force by this electrical solenoid, what will happen? Pressure port P will get connected to B and working port A will get connected to the second exhaust port, that is R. Now this electrical solenoid requires electrical energy, which will be provided through the switch. So when the switch is open, the coil is not energized and the spool remains in the position that is being presently shown. But when the switch is closed, the circuit is completed, the coil will be energized. So the coil will then pull the spool towards the left against the spring force and the position will change. Let us see the animation of this. So what we saw here was that since this is the position when the coil is not energized, so when we start simulation, air from the compressor moves through the port P to the port A into the cylinder and the piston moves forward. When we operated this switch, the coil was energized, it pulled the spool towards the left, then the port A was connected to exhaust port R and pressure port P was connected to a working port B, and accordingly the piston moved backward. So let us see one more the animation once more. So now what we have seen is that we started with a single acting pneumatic actuator which was being controlled by a single 3x2 manually operated directional control valve. Then we saw the operation of a double acting cylinder operated by two 3x2 manual directional control valves, and now we have come to electropneumatics, where the valve, directional control valve, is not operated manually but by electrical means. Now the next step is incorporating the controllers, right? And basically, because here if you see, this switch is being controlled manually, right? So the construction of the switch shows it's like a doorbell switch. So do you have to apply a force against the spring, and when you apply the force against the spring, the contacts are made, the circuit is completed and the solenoid is energized. Similarly, when you release the force, the spring pushes the contacts up, thereby the circuit is broken or the circuit is open and the coil is de-energized. Now we want this switch to be operated not manually but automatically. So that will be done by a controller. So we can have a controller which may operate a relay. So this will be replaced by a relay, or it may be replaced by an electronic switch. So next we will see some videos. In videos we will see a controller operating the pneumatic actuators, and those videos have been made in our lab only. So in this videos you will see a PLC being used. So as I said that in this session I will skip some of the slides because we will deal in detail with the PLC or programmable logic controller in tomorrow's session. But a very brief introduction. So what is a programmable logic controller? It is a digital electronic device that uses a programmable memory to store instructions and to implement functions such as logic, sequencing, timing, counting, and arithmetic in order to control machines and processes. Now a computer is also a digital electronic device. A computer also uses a programmable memory A computer can also store instructions, and a computer can also implement all these functions. The difference is that PLCs are designed to operate in industrial environment, that is under high temperature, vibrations, etc. So in brief, they are more rugged as compared to computers or laptops. Otherwise, technically, they are similar to PCs only. They have their microprocessors, they have their RAMs, their ROM, input-output ports, and all the associated circuits. So if we just look at very briefly at the history of PLCs, the early machine control was through cams, gears, levers, etc. Then came the wired relay and switch control elements. Then programmable logic controllers came into existence in late 1960s, and this was done by industrial environment, automobile, high temperature, vibrations, etc. Okay. Initially, these PLCs were called programmable controllers or PCs. But in 1980s, when PCs became personal computers became very popular in the world, and PLCs were only confined to the industries, so the term PC was then generally associated with a personal computer. So therefore, the programmable controllers nomenclature was changed to programmable logic controllers, and now they are called as PLCs. So this is a photograph of the PLC that we have in our lab. So in the videos also, you will see this PLC in action. In general, this is the block diagram of a PLC. A PLC will receive...
Initially, these PLCs were called programmable controllers or PCs. But in 1980s, when PCs became very personal computers became very popular,
is there a lag? Okay. So a PLC will receive inputs from the sensors which are connected to the devices, and we will have a control program or logic fed into the PLC. So based upon the logic and the sensor information, the PLC will control the output devices such as motors, relays, etc. So you can see this is a block diagram of a PLC, very similar to a personal computer. It has a CPU, it has input interface, output interface, it has volatile memory, RAM, and it has non-volatile program backup memory. So if we compare PLC versus PC, a personal computer is optimized for calculations and display tasks. And moreover, a personal computer is a very general device.
Control program or logic fed into the PLC. So based upon the logic,
it relies on software for running different types of programs. A computer is programmed by a specialist, whereas a PLC is designed for logic control and regulation tasks. It is programmed by non-specialists, and a PLC is well adapted to industrial environment. Now, for programming a PLC, we may connect it to a computer. The reason being that PLCs, they may be very small in size, and the display, the LCD display on them is also smaller in size. And sometimes they may have a very small control panel with limited number of keys. So it becomes cumbersome to program a PLC directly. So what we can do is we can easily make a program for the PLC on a computer where you have a full keyboard, screen, and an interface software for the PLC in which you will make the program and then transfer the program to the PLC. Now, if you look at this elaborate block diagram of a PLC, what we see is a CPU, memory, communication channel for communicating with a PLC with a computer, power supply, and some kind of expansion connections. And we have input and output interfaces. But here, if you see in input and output interfaces, screw terminals for input lines and output lines are shown. In a computer, you have input and output interfaces in terms of USB ports, serial ports, parallel ports, etc. Whereas here, we will have screw terminals where we will attach the wires from the sensors on the input side and wires from the driver circuits of the output devices on the output side. So these are some of the typical features of PLCs. Like if we want to buy a computer, what we'll do is we specify a computer in terms of its clock speed, its hard disk storage capacity, its volatile memory storage capacity, the number of ports, especially USB ports these days. Whereas similarly in PLC also we specify that, okay, what kind of power supply does it require? That is AC or DC. What is the capacity of programming? How many steps can be incorporated in one program? What is the execution speed? How many microseconds does it take to execute one step? How many inputs are there? How many outputs are there? And what is the type of inputs and outputs? Because here we may have analog and digital sensors or analog and digital outputs. Now, timers and counters are two very important parts of PLCs. So how many timers are there? Up to what time they can count? Similarly, how many counters are there and up to how much value they can count? And there may be other mathematical functions, some mathematical functions to say add or subtract the signals, or control functions like proportional integral derivative and fuzzy control, etc. So these are some major manufacturers of PLCs: Allen Bradley, Siemens, Omron, ABB, Mitsubishi, Koyo, etc. This we will skip. Next we will come to the videos for PLCs, but before we do that, we will now break for tea.